Welcome to Lights, Camera, Action, Lincoln Park, and the Movies. My name is Fran Casey, and I'm the Director of Community Affairs here at DePaul University, and I'm delighted that you're all here to join us this evening. Just for a few of you who may not be familiar with the Research Initiative began in 1999 during DePaul's centennial year celebration. In fact, one of the original organizers is just walking to her seat right now, as are some of our committee members who are here this evening. We began the Research Initiative as a way to collect, document, and share and celebrate the history that we have all shared in Lincoln Park, the neighborhood community, and the university community. We have worked on this now for about 12 years. This is our 23rd program. And yes, thank you. That would be lovely. We have these programs to highlight different aspects of our history here in Lincoln Park. And many of you have been here for all of our programs, for which we are very grateful. Tonight's program, as I said, is Lincoln Park and the Movies. And it is moderated by one of our very own faculty members, Hugh Ingrasci. Hugh grew up in St. Louis, had family ties here in Chicago, and eventually, and wisely, I might add, gravitated to Chicago. He had stops along the way at the University of Michigan, Syracuse University, and spent a time at three different Chilean universities as a Fulbright scholar. Hugh teaches several courses here at DePaul, exploring modern American fiction, film and American culture, film noir and neo-film noir, the American dream and nightmare as it's seen in film and in fiction. We are so delighted to welcome Hugh and our panelists, Rich Moskal, director of the City of Chicago Film Center, and Milos Stehlik, the director of Facets Multimedia. And with that, I'm going to turn the rest of the introductions over to Hugh Ingrasci. Oh, one last thing. If any of you parked in the Sheffield garage and you've got the ticket with you, there is a stamp machine on the information desk here in our student center, and if you get it stamped before you leave, then you get the visitor's rate. So, Hugh.
Last week I was at a conference, one of my former students was there in Milwaukee, and I caught you cold every 5 years, and it was that week. And I was laryngeal, so I hope it's not so bad tonight. I'm really happy that we're all able to, I think, partake of Fran's generosity. She spent a lot of time putting this together. We just kind of show up, and I guess we're the prize chimpanzees that get to perform. In any event, I'm really happy because I'm going to start by introducing Milos. And Milos Stehlik is 35 years the director, owner, am I correct as well?
Correct.
Just the director of Facets Multimedia. Just for a show of hands, how many have ever been to Facets? Almost everybody. So I don't have to tell you, you turn left on Fullerton, you go about six blocks, and if you need a parking spot, Walgreens is right across the street. You have to have long legs to get up the big, huge sidewalk, and if you park there, you can't open your door, so watch out for that. I've been using Facets since I got here, and I do teach film. I told them we purchased through DePaul's library and for the English department probably 100 films since I've been here, which I've taught in class. They have everything, as you perhaps know. I'm most happy about the fact that if you're a member, you get a discount on rentals. I've also bought documentaries, Ken Burns stuff, PBS things, and particularly short fiction by American authors is on film, as well as novels. I was sort of amazed. I found out some years ago that Wise Blood by Flannery O'Connor had been made into a movie by John Huston. And he's an agnostic, almost an atheist, and I couldn't believe that, but it's true. I got hold of the film, and his writer and director were O'Connor fans and Catholics, so it was all right. But anyway, it's my favorite films. I'll start with the notion of Facets as being one of the literary treasures of the world, because it's really film as art. And Milos is, I think, involved, as he'll tell you himself, with producing, no, but distributing. He gets films that are worthwhile, they would find channels otherwise difficult. He's not pushing blockbuster movies. he's not pushing movies that can be easily distributed, but he's doing it on his own. And what I like is that European films, which are one of my favorites, come out of that. The rest, his background before FAST, this I'll let you discover later. My last connection with him is I had a graduate student who did a master's thesis on Hitchcock films, Vertigo and Marnie. And he later applied to and taught a course at Facets. Have any of you taken courses at Facets? That's something I wish Milos would talk about, because they're really worthwhile, and it's a really literate audience. They're filmophiles, and I really enjoy those as well. I've been through one of those, never invited to teach because I teach here. It's a competitor. Then we'll take up Richard Moskal, and I have to do this under the lights. It's very small print. This is his own blurb, so I hope he appreciates it. He's been the director of the Chicago Film Office, which is responsible nerve center for all the city coordination to make films in Chicago. To attract them as well? Yes?
Yes.
Okay. He's done that since 1996. It's a division of the Mayor's Office of Special Events. He makes possible any production of feature films, television movies, series, commercials, documentaries, and any news media. Before this position, he was a project manager for the Illinois Film Office, as well as a freelance location manager for a dozen feature and television productions. The Fugitive, that's the movie with Harrison Ford?
Correct, yeah.
Okay, not the TV series, you're not that old.
No,
that's
not
true,
TV
okay. Series. Miracle on 34th Street and To Sir With Love, film two. He was also a co-founder and contributing editor of some publications. One, the Chicago Film Letter, occasionally contributes to the Chicago Reader and the Chicago Magazine, which are all good company. He's a Chicago native. He went to Loyola University and graduated, right?
Yeah.
Okay. He's married and he has twin sons, and his wife is a documentary filmmaker. Suzanne, is it Suffredin?
Suffredin.
With that, I'm going to turn it over to Rich Moskal, who's going to show us film clips, if our heads are not in the way, of Chicago on film. Am I right?
Correct. First of all, anybody see To Sir With Love 2? No, man.
was Sidney Poitier in that, or did you just...
He was. It was a TV movie sequel to the classic To Sir With Love. I haven't read that in a long, long time, but anyway, To Sir With Love 2. Sidney Poitier. Check it out. It was,
but maybe you should have signed in your class.
I should.
Yeah. And Lulu makes a guest appearance in it.
Right, and I should send all my students to his place at $5 a clip so he can get a living, too. So are we ready for the film showing?
Well, this is essentially just a very, very brief synopsis of the blockbuster type films that have been made here in Chicago. Not all blockbusters, obviously, but films that have been made in Chicago dating back to when things started to happen on a regular basis to the Blues Brothers up until a more current day.
Take it up a notch. But you don't want to blow your wad, so then you gotta cool it off a notch.
What did she say? The moment I wake up. Before I put on my makeup,
I say a little prayer for you.
A special prayer for Mother Jo, who has provided for the Roman hour of the rep. Beautiful breasts and delicious legs under the, on the table. Lord, all I'm asking is bless this bread, bless this meat, and bless my stomach, cause I was going to eat.
There are a lot of rules.
Field, tryouts, play. That's it. Get lost.
Tell me, where are you?
St. Louis.
Well, this is definitely Lower Wacker Drive.
Second city because after the great Chicago fire of 1871, Chicago was rebuilt on its ruins. The city came back even bigger and stronger than it originally was. So it's not really an insult. It's more of a badge of honor to be called.
Cassius and Maya.
My name ain't Cassius Clay. That is a slave name and I am a free man. I am Muhammad Ali.
You know, I apologize. I apologize to you on the air. Your name is Muhammad Ali. You have a right to be called whatever you want.
Are you the king of anything? Like what?
Anything. King of the lanes at the local bowling alley.
King of the lanes?
King of the lanes. King of the trolls.
King of the trolls?
I have bacon fat in my hands. That's okay?
Great. I can wash this shower and run in the rain and it'll swim. Oh. Come on. Give it a good pull. Come on, honey.
And I don't want to make it.
It's okay. It's okay. I'm fine.
Okay.
Give it a good pull.
Turn it up like this.
Day when the light is so clear that I can touch every detail, every brick and window in the buildings I love. Come on, take a walk with me. This Saturday, let me show you.
You're crazy. Why are you going through all this trouble for me?
No trouble. Summer's here.
Walk down the street, I'm thinking. Everybody moving along. I've got a sad.
What the hell are you dressed for? Halloween?
Shut up. I'm working.
Where?
The circus.
Otis. Plug it in.
I know that Chuck Norris has shot his cop martial arts films. Did Steven Seagal ever think we were cool enough to make a movie here?
He did.
He did?
He did. He made Above the Law.
He did here.
Yeah.
Because I recognize, usually it's Brooklyn and all that stuff, and he made one here.
He did, in fact. Above the Law, I think, was his first movie.
Right.
Andy Davis, who directed Chuck Norris in Code of Silence, was known for working with actors who can't act. And... And Steven Seagal showed up, and they made Above the Law here in Chicago.
And Chuck Norris anticipated Spider-Man by jumping on top of the L. I know that. Did Seagal jump on the L, too? They usually
I don't think he did.
Okay.
I don't think he did.
Anyway, I just wanted to start off with 12 films that I got a list. I think it's from Rich Moskal, of area right here that scenes were shot. The first one is Return to Me at the Twin Anchors on Sedgwick. How many ever been to Twin Anchors? We all been there? All drunks? That's it. Okay. The Breakup along Armitage Avenue, The Breakup. Okay. The third one, League of Their Own. Everybody must know that one. That's my daughter's favorite. That was Madonna Mary's at the St. James Lutheran Church, which is three blocks from here.
Mm-hmm.
Am I right? Right? Public Enemies at my favorite, The Biograph. I have a little story for you. Julie, name... with Tal, the last one, lived up near St. Patrick High School, and I taught her son when I first got here. He had a really bad case of diabetes, and I used to inject him during homeroom. We'd take him in the back room. She got to like me. I got to go to their place for Christmas dinner, and Julie sold John Dillinger the ticket the night he got killed. And she got arrested for doing it because they thought she should have known, since she had seen him before, it was Dillinger and should have turned him in. So she's got a roll of tickets from that night, and her proudest night is she saw John and he got killed. So that was right at the Biograph. Another one of my favorites, My Bodyguard, was shot in Lincoln Park, high school film. This one is The Babe, which is the new Babe Ruth film, and that's St. Vincent de Paul Rectory, and that was the orphanage, I guess, for Babe Ruth. Okay. And then About Last Night, which is Kelly's Pub, not too far from here. The Last Leaf, as Art Carney was in it, at Armitage Stop, owned by Bonneville Films, and it was supposed to represent a Mormon church, something like that, it says here. Can you correct that? I don't make any sense out of it, but we'll go on. Richie Rich, one of my favorite Macaulay Culkin films. He made it after Home Alone. And... The real thing was shot at the Biltmore, which is a big mansion in North Carolina. But they came here, if you know our Princeton-looking buildings called the Commons, they shot here too. I was really shocked because I didn't recognize it in the film. There's a sword fight scene in the Quarterly Hill Commons. Above the Law, and that's Seagal?
That is, yeah.
Okay, I'm good on Seagal. Armitage, L Stop. The Color of Money, a pool hall on Fullerton, not too far from here. And Thief,
Smart Bar.
Thief, notice this, Thief. I think former governors were shot at Finkelsteel, okay? If you don't know it, that's where he said his inauguration, I want to run, I'm a good guy, give me all your money, and all that sort of stuff. In any event...
And most recently, the most iconic of Lincoln Park locations, the Wiener Circle, was used for
that's right.
The Dilemma, which Vince Vaughn and Ron Howard just made this
right. Vince is one of our stalwarts. He's one that always pushes to get films made.
He's one, thank God, he's one of a growing number of people who are in a position to essentially dictate where their films are going to be made. And Vince has been extraordinarily loyal in bringing just about everything he's done here.
Some other stars, Phil Murray would be one that's very instrumental in coming here.
Phil Murray, dating back to when John Hughes, I think, the late, great John Hughes, who did all of the Home Alone films and started out with Breakfast Club and 16 Candles and Ferris Bueller's Day Off. He was essentially a filmmaking machine and helped put Chicago very much on the map.
Mm-hmm.
And Bonnie Hunt, who brought Return to Me to Chicago. In fact, Bonnie's mandate for all the locations for that film is that they be within walking distance to what was her former apartment when she used to live in Chicago when she was working at Northwestern Hospital as an oncology nurse.
Did Bonnie ever do Second City? I'm trying to.
Yep.
She was a stand-up.
Yep. She was at Second City.
Okay. I have a lead-off question because I'm not quite sure what to ask Milos yet, and that is my recollection of Chicago, and not the setting, that is the actual physical city in the film, but the place where the action took place is the black and white criminal films. And if you were from Chicago in the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s, some of which I was not alive, and you went to Europe, you said, I'm from Chicago, or Chicago, whatever you say, they'd say, oh, rat-a-tat-tat, Al Capone, and all that sort of stuff. And that's what I can recall. I can remember Scarface, and I told him all of the Native Son, which is shot on the south side, it's got a black killer, all the Italian killers, except for the Godfather films, and that almost all the black and white films are ethnic, and they're shot in sleazo neighborhoods, and everything you saw is in glowing color, and it's lakefront cool. I just wondered if there's been a revolution sort of as we became an upscale kind of city, the films changed with us, or we got upscale kinds of people that recommend us to be made into films?
I think the Chicago's identity, frankly, has changed and evolved, and filmmakers who probably were coming here in the 60s and 70s had a very different notion of what Chicago was, a rather sort of dragged knuckles, broken nose, back alley grit to it. And I think as a destination for romantic comedies and even suspense thrillers of the type of the movie Wanted, which was a very very slick and very gritty, but it, as an image of Chicago, it wasn't the days of knocking any doors.
Right.
Milos, you can probably speak to this being more of a film historian.
I'm not a historian, but I think that that the production of films in Chicago shifted from just being kind of the pickup location in a way to being films that maybe had Chicago in mind a little bit. I mean, as the image of Chicago in films grew, it became more prominent as an urban environment in some ways. Another city other than New York or LA, and so that kind of identity for a large urban, very American city in a way became more thematically intertwined into the scripts themselves. So that kind of worked hand in hand.
And I do think at least the directors who were coming to Chicago, who perhaps had never been to Chicago before, there was an excitement. And I think a big element of surprise of seeing the city and changing its notion of what they thought the city looked like. Everybody sort of knew the L, and everybody sort of knew fire escapes, and everybody knew about the Chicago Fire and deep dish pizza and all that. But in terms of skyline and architecture and lakefront and elegance and sophistication, I think those notions of what Chicago looked like started showing up in movies. And even something like The Blues Brothers, which had a sort of very cliche version of Chicago, opened people's eyes. And in fact, I think, you know, perhaps from our standpoint, the best audience for The Blues Brothers were other filmmakers and other studios who perhaps were seeing Chicago for the first time, and in fact said, Jesus, they'll let you do anything in Chicago based on what they were seeing there. And that sort of drove more interest of other people coming here to take a look at it.
I'd like to springboard with Milos. If you're not aware of it, the big three in production of drama and great acting and great plays and lots of plays in production were London and New York and Chicago. We were always third, and we're now first. There's more good drama in Chicago than any city in the world. More good actors and more plays because it's affordable to produce them here. So we've become an artistic center for the whole world. And I want to talk about film and how in your 35 years here, Chicago's become a center not only for production of film, but for a cadre of people that are producing artists. And your place, Facets, I think reflects this.
Well, you know, I would say, just to back up, you know, Chicago's film history remains largely an unwritten chapter, because it's only been written written in terms of Hollywood, in some ways, some kind of productions. But there is a really history of Chicago as a center for educational film production, which dates back to the 50s, 60s, 70s, and beyond, in which it really was the center of 16-millimeter film production, in which many filmmakers got training, worked. It has there's a case to be made, which I think is very valid, of the Chicago documentary, quote-unquote, school, not to invent movements or new waves here, or anything, but which really started with John Grierson being at the University of Chicago and being kind of radicalized there in a way to the idea that film could be a medium of social change, social communication, out of which grew a very strong documentary movement. Again, today, known in a recent way through Hoop Dreams, Kartemquin films, many documentary filmmakers, but having a much, much longer history going back to the 1960s, to the 1950s, which led to the founding of Columbia College in some way with film production. So I don't know this history. It's a history that remains to be written. Judy mm-hmm. Hoffman, who's a documentary filmmaker herself and teaches at the University of Chicago, recently had some students kind of assigned and doing oral histories and projects on trying to piece these elements together. But I think that legacy is much greater and much larger and much, much bigger and largely has been unsung. It's probably in some way a political failure to the first Mayor mm-hmm. Daley, who didn't like film too much, so nobody paid much attention to this and we really didn't think of ourselves as a film city. But the resources, the number of filmmakers, the number of young people, the variety of films, independent films that are made here, not just documentary, but a lot of experimental cinema. You know, we have one of the centers of experimental video distribution in yep. the Video Data Bank in Chicago, for example, which very few people know. So the number of resources that exist here in terms of organizations that work with kids in using video in education, I mean, it's really much, much, much vaster than any of us imagined. We're an odd city because for many years, whenever I brought filmmakers to Facets from other countries, which of course we still do, the first, well, especially Polish filmmakers, we used to like to, you know, have a little nip as soon as they arrive and say, well, where's the bar where all the filmmakers go? Well, there is no such bar, you know, but I mean, there is an equivalent of that.
The Billy Goat Tavern with the politicians, right?
Well, that exists, right, but it doesn't even exist for filmmakers. So, you know, there's no, in an odd way, what's odd about this city is that we are, at least that's my experience and personal view, but I think we are very bad at singing our own praises. We don't know how to do that. It's a very weird second city mentality, which is a construct of the mind, but very one which is very ingrained and very difficult to defeat, and with which many people will argue, but then not really be good ambassadors for Chicago. And the second thing is that because of this kind of deep working class ethic, in a way, we all work very hard and work probably much harder than we should. So in a way, a lot of the film community lives in isolation from each other, much greater isolation than it should or needs to. Mm-hmm. But Rich can change that and bring that about.
I would agree. I think it's tremendous when Hollywood filmmakers come to Chicago and it grabs a lot of attention and even headlines and gets people talking about, oh, they're making movies in Chicago now, when in fact that has been going on for many, many years, very quietly, perhaps without the spectacle of, let's say, a Transformers 3 or something like that. And it is unfortunate that history of Chicago isn't something that people sort of identify immediately with Chicago as, like, mm-hmm. in the way that perhaps New York has that sort of that identity of being not just a place where Hollywood film is made, but where locally produced independent films or off the beaten track films that don't appeal to such a broad audience or a box office demand, but I would.
Well, and you need all elements, you know. I mean, one, you know, I mean, the hottest cinema artistically these days is coming out of Romania. You know, you can't really say why, but one reason is, and this is the kind of the top-down tier theory. Many of the Romanian filmmakers really got their training working on low-budget Hollywood films in Romania, which were, you know, a lot of horror, junk, mm-hmm. slasher, TV genre stuff. But because it's two things. You have to be able to practice your craft, and you have to be able to live. It's two things. So when you see a great, very interesting film by a filmmaker who wins all kinds of prizes at film festivals worldwide, like Christy Puyu, he got his training working on low-budget horror films. So you really need the industry there, and you need that commercial element to fuel that infrastructure and fuel the craft of filmmaking, because it's a collaborative art. Yes, of course, today you can make a film with a digital camera, but you still need somebody to write it, somebody to act it if it's going to be a narrative film. So the great films of all time really are histories of really great collaborations.
I wanted to follow up on one that he talked about. Milos talked about the history in Chicago of film, and one I did not know about until I watched a documentary about 10 years ago. There was an African-American named Oscar Michaux, M-I-C-H-A-U-X, and he had sort of, I think, New Orleans, sort of Bourbon roots, and he was a black filmmaker who made race films. Race films are, you're making for a black audience, you do it on the cheap, you usually get people who are trying to make it in Hollywood or New York, and they come into town. You shoot them in 3 or 4 days. You have all rental equipment. You don't have any new stuff. And the big notion is they were shown in normal theaters, but no white person ever saw them. They waited till the movie house shut down. They cleaned it out. And at midnight, they were also called midnight movies, the black audience would come in, and they'd watch these films. Many of them were knockoffs of white films. Cowboy stings. It's really hilarious to see these guys who can't rope riding these horses on the streets of Chicago trying to play cowboy. The love story, and they tried to get Lena Horne to make one, but they couldn't get her to Chicago. Eventually she went and made Stormy Weather, I think, in Hollywood or New York. So that leads to the fact that we have a storied history of experimental filmmaking in this town.
You had Ebony Film Corporation,
yes,
which was by which there's a documentary made by Bill Grisham some years ago, maybe 20 years ago, which was an all-black studio for producing these all-black films, which were made in Chicago.
And my students asked me what happened to the industry. Hollywood discovered there was a black audience, and they just stole the whole trade and made it themselves. And they started by stealing stars like Lena Horne and later Belafonte. Which leads me to this question. I guess by natural selection, because you have the major, let's say, NYU, Columbia film schools in the east, and also Southern Cal and places like UCLA on the west, and movies started in New York, a little bit in Chicago, but on the west coast. Mm-hmm. We have that as a disadvantage. We do have Columbia, which exclusively makes artists. We have DePaul's invested a huge amount of money in film production now. What other pluses do we have for this cadre of beautiful, wonderful actors that we have here, just dying to make films in Chicago to make us go forward?
Flashpoint Academy, which is a relatively new school. It's an accelerated program dedicated to media arts, and not a technical school necessarily, but really trying to give young filmmakers the tools they need to get out and actually make product or get jobs and things like that. I think there's a new generation. There's almost like every semester there's another generation of filmmakers that are going out on Chicago streets, and Columbia rivals, student body-wise, it's the largest film school in the country right at the moment. Yep. And
the biggest, did you hear that? It's the largest in the city, not UCLA.
Yeah, in the country. So as much as I think from a the status of NYU and the status of UCLA as far as film schools go, Chicago, in just sheer numbers, is generating new filmmakers, new generations of filmmakers, and the fact that there is Hollywood work here that perhaps gives them the opportunity to cut their teeth and earn a living and get a trade going and things like that.
What's the entry point, the bread and butter? Do you get into making commercials if you want to go from Chicago to the big time?
You know, I don't think commercial production has just because people just don't watch commercials the way they used to. The advertisers
not
don't want to spend
a deal anymore.
They're just bypassing commercials, and as much as there's a lot of viral video out there and things like that.
Okay.
People are getting into it either one, working as breaking in as production assistants and just seeing how Hollywood filmmakers do it, or working on student productions and collaborating with other students and essentially just making their own films. As Milo said, I mean, the cost of making a film these days is a fraction of what it used to, just to buy a light, just to rent a light package was extraordinary.
Well, I remember Janusz Kaminski was a great cinematographer who shot Schindler's List and who went to school at Columbia, and I remember the story of how he came to Chicago, went to School of the Art Institute first. Nobody wanted to talk to him. Then he went down the street to Columbia. He went to school, and probably 50% of the student films that you would see coming out of Columbia at any given year were by shot by Janusz Kaminski, because all he wanted to do, it was his obsessive way, was he wanted to shoot. And obviously, through this very, it's very tough, but through this very hard dedication, obsession, he became, you know, world-class cinematographer, a mediocre director, because, you know, there's always the element of arrogance. I'm on this side of the camera, I can be on the other side. Rarely works, but certainly a great cameraman.
And his roommate, while here in Chicago, went on to be the DP for Avatar, was nominated. Did he win the Academy Award? I think he did win the Academy Award for Avatar.
I was going to follow up by saying I covered you from 1975 to now. What did you do before that?
Nothing having to do with film. You know, I owned a bookstore.
Just a displaced person? What were you?
I studied science, actually. That was my background, which I eventually gave up. And so film for me was totally an avocation.
And you met somebody, and they got you interested in Facets? How did it start?
No, I started Facets together with Nicole Dreisky. Actually, at the time that I owned a bookstore, which was not far from here, I showed some films there, kind of just as a promotional thing for the bookstore. And then there was a theater, again, down the street on Halsted and Armitage, called at the Drama Shelter, which was doing not such great theater, but was having a tough time. And so I said, well, why don't we show some films on, you know, your Dark Nights? And that was really the beginning of my film exhibition career. And then about a year later, the film series was actually very successful, more successful than their plays, so a lot of interscene jealousy. And so we went to look out for a space of our own with no money, and that turned out to be Resurrection Lutheran Church in Lakeview, where where we showed films in a hall, meeting hall. And then a year after that, a volunteer found an abandoned church of our own, which was the former Grace Lutheran Church, which I must say is now the not so pretty history of Lincoln Park. Was our episode at Grace Lutheran Church, which was on Belden and Geneva Terrace, which had been a Lutheran church, which had a quite progressive pastor, who did guitar, folk services, runaway treatment counseling, and at a time when Lincoln Park in the 70s was still a neighborhood a little bit in transition, it had gentrified, but not to the extent that it is today. And very naively, I went to the Lincoln Park Conservation Association and said, oh, here we are, you know, we're going to show films. And the reason that the Lutheran Church rented the church is because it had been abandoned. And so there was a lot of vandalism, and they wanted somebody to occupy it. So with volunteer help, we built a giant screen in front of the altar, showed films from the church choir loft, and started almost every single day of the week. And very soon, suddenly, the neighborhood reaction started. About every piece of paper on the... I got more parking tickets in that one year than I ever got from that, because they would watch from the windows and call the cops, you know?
What was the
just worried that the dangerous you know, bad element was going to come into the neighborhood and bring down their home values.
Really?
And subsequently, the church also rented the basement to an alternative school. They acted never directly, but always through the city, building inspections department, on. And the ultimate court case was over zoning, was whether or not we had changed the use of the church. A case which we probably would have won, because hey, church is public assembly, movies is public assembly. You know, not a particularly different definition. But unfortunately, in the meantime, there was a warfare within the Lutheran church, so they decided to sell the church. We had to move. And of course, they tore it down. It's a very ugly condominium now. And so after a search, our career began on Fullerton Avenue. Pat Mikus, who is here, is a very old-time volunteer who
moved those chairs.
Moved those chairs. Who helped, build the new, the first stage of Facets on Fullerton, which we did with $3,000 and volunteer help. So,
As an aside, about 10 years after, it was about 1985, my wife and I had hit a couple of good stocks, and we had our life savings built up. We'd both worked jobs before our kids came. We were going to take $75,000 of our money and $80,000 of our parents' money and do the dream job and retire from DePaul. It was going to be a private bookstore and video store rental. Uh-huh. And just before we did it, a gal moved into the neighborhood who's the daughter of the guy who started Blockbuster, and she said, "Don't do it. My daddy will kill you." And we didn't. Yeah, thank God we didn't, too.
Thank God she moved.
I was going to follow up the question with, unless you have something you want to add.
I was just going to say, in terms of pioneering mail order video,
sure.
Facets beat Netflix to the punch. Sure.
Obviously we show films every single day of the week, but we went into video with Fear and Trepidation in 1983. There was still a time when anybody who had anything to do with video was somehow committing a sin against the art of film. You could only see it pristine format, 35 millimeter. Anything on video was really just like muckraking or I would say that Roger Ebert was a great push behind. He could say, "Well, you have to do. You should have video." So we did do that by buying 140 of the, I would say, be the classic canon of art cinema, and taping the boxes, empty boxes, to the wall, storing the real tapes in the basement. And whenever somebody wanted to rent a tape, the projectionist had to get it, run to the basement, bring it back and rent it. Very soon, of course, the collection grew. Then we had to publish a catalog. Then people started buying videos. We became a large distributor of ultimately 65,000 titles, a lot to libraries and institutions. And we began renting VHS at the time by mail. I mean, you have to send it back. It was $10, and you'd have to send it back, pay your own postage back. We'd pay the postage to you. So that was in the early days, and in the early days we had probably 4,000 out-of-state members who subscribe to this VHS video rental by mail service. Obviously, Netflix greatly improved on the idea because they found that DVD was much cheaper to mail because it weighed a lot less than a VHS tape, and that you could do it all online. So the rest is history.
Mm-hmm. I'll come back here in a minute and ask you about some of the current programs you're running, but I was going to ask Rich, Transformers 1, was it 3 that we made Transformers?
3.
Yeah, I watched the first one. I'll have the guts to watch the second scene. Can you walk us through the logistics of getting that thing and putting it down in downtown and getting all the people out of the way and keeping the gawkers and only one accident? How did that all go?
Well, Michael Bay, who directed it, had looked at Chicago as a location for Transformers 1. He really liked Chicago. He really liked the idea of shooting in Chicago. And it just didn't materialize for Transformers 1. And then Transformers 2, I think, was set in more of a sort of an industrial landscape. So when Transformers 3 came along, and he had also produced, he has another company called Platinum Dunes, which essentially does lower budget remakes of classic 1980s horror films like Nightmare on Elm Street and Last House on the Left and things like that. So he had a very strong familiarity with Chicago, really liked the look of Chicago and thought it would be a great place, and initially just came to Chicago with the idea of using the Michigan Avenue Bridge for what was essentially going to be 2 weekends. There was no great plan to shoot a lot here, but the more that the came into Chicago and sent his production team to Chicago to start investigating other locations and things like that, I think the more he realized there was a great cinematic landscape that could be utilized as part of this big finale. The third act of the film is really just a showdown between the Decepticons and the, if you're at all a Transformers fan, the Decepticons and the who are the other guys? Come on, Transformer freaks, you're out there. You know what's going on. Let's go. The Decepticons and the Autobots.
Autobots.
There you go. Okay. But Michigan Avenue was always where they wanted to do the big scene, and that was the money shot, and that was where you're going to get the, you know, the great cinematic value of seeing these robots, which of course you never really saw when they were filming here because that was all digitally generated. But the mayhem in their path of debris falling and stuff blowing up essentially was all something that they wanted to do on what is Chicago's busiest and most high-profile stretch of real estate.
Are they like a circus troupe that come in with these huge trucks and it's all their gang? Or do you have to get your union guys to augment?
They, I mean, as much as they came in with a lot of people, it's a traveling show. They shot in Chicago, they shot in Los Angeles, they shot in Florida, they shot in Washington, D.C. So they brought a fair amount of number of people with them. But because of this, the size of that production was so enormous, they still ended up hiring 300 to 400 Chicago crew people just to man what was the enormity of special effects and stunts and just all the equipment. I mean, it was an ambitious production condensed into what ended up being about 2 months of filming here in Chicago. Perhaps the most challenging was Michigan Avenue because of where it was, but they were doing some extraordinary things just about everywhere they went in the city.
And Public Enemy shot right up
the street. And I will say that, you know, they were extraordinarily good partners in saying, look, we want to do some big things, and worked with us very closely in terms of holding press conferences to talk about the fact that, hey, this is really going to screw things up. This is going to close down a lot of streets, and it's going to be impactful. But there's a good story too, in that it's going to bring great revenue to the city, and that's, you know, that's part of our interest, is that this is economic development. It's good business. There's additional benefits in that there are a lot of, we've learned almost immediately, there's a ton of Transformer fans out there, strong, from you know, knee-high up people who love Transformers, who are coming in from all points around to stay in Chicago hotels and get a close bird's eye view of what Transformers was all about.
And then Public Enemies, which I walked over to for lunch almost every day, how did they get the restaurants all shut down and put up these false fronts, and did they just pay them for all the money they would lose? Or
they dropped a fair amount of money on Lincoln Avenue.
Not the city, but the producers did all this.
Oh no, the city doesn't pay a dime. I mean, the city, that's the good news. It's like, you know, it's, as you as taxpayers should know, that when the city hosts film production, it's not your money that's going to pay for the city services and the police and all of that stuff. That's all paid for by the production. In Public Enemy's case, I mean, they paid the businesses all up and down that stretch of Lincoln Avenue. They paid for a lot of stuff. I mean, there was a big budget production.
So they paid for all the police?
They paid for the pastries that were in the windows of the bakeries that they created that you never really saw. I mean, if there was one, I mean, I really liked, I don't know how you felt about the movie. I really liked Public Enemies, but all the attention to detail that went into the making of that film to make it look perfect was very much in the distance from what was a very cinema verite type production of almost documentary style in terms of how that film looked. I thought it had a great look, but considering how, and Michael Mann, who is a native Chicago and who did other movies here in Chicago, Thief, perhaps his first film, and then others after that, is known for his attention to detail and his interest in wanting it to be exactly right, just right. Spent a lot of Universal's money to make it just right.
Well, a local social studies in an elementary school near us, the teacher used it as a field trip to show life in the 1930s. And they spent a whole morning there just looking around and taking camera shots and everything else and being, a pest in the way because they're all little kids.
Well, there was something very sort of old Hollywood about the production design, the fact that they did those types. I mean, these days, there's so much digital effects that go, there's no need really to do all of that sort of fabrication and redressing. But they did it all, and they did it right down to the T. And it was a fun thing to see. I mean, it really was a cool thing to see. And it was a cool thing to watch him film with cars, the costumes, the people who lived in the neighborhood weren't too fond of the Tommy guns that were going off all night long. But it was visually speaking, it was really quite the spectacle.
We have a captive film buff audience here, and I just wanted to give you an opportunity. I talked about Ante Stelliano, my student's course in film noir, mm-hmm. and he loved it. He had a great group of people. Mm-hmm. What are some of the series you've had recently or upcoming that interested people might be
to? We teach film history, so currently there are classes in Fellini and Errol Morris, the great documentary filmmaker, Gates of Heaven, Fog of War. We obviously show films every day of the week. Starting tomorrow is a very interesting documentary called Budrus, which is about a Palestinian village which is divided, which has the wall built, made by a young Israeli filmmaker. You know, we publish DVDs, so we're involved in a number of projects, actually some Chicago restoration projects. The films of Gordon Weissenborn, who was a great documentary filmmaker, but who made films in the early 70s here, which were quite revolutionary for children, which were made for the Erickson Institute. And like Water is Wet, which was for early childhood education, for kids to get connected to the sense in a sensory way to the idea of water, for example. We just finished the Chicago International Children's Film Festival, which is now the oldest and largest festival of films for kids in North America. This year we showed 270 films for kids to about 26,000 kids, mm-hmm. Both at Facets, this year for the first time also at the Nature Museum, at the Regal Theater on Western Avenue, at Northwestern University in Hyde Park. The festival brings in about 140 filmmakers who came to do workshops with kids. So you can find all of that, you know, at www.facets.org. But don't stop there, you know. Get a little exercise and walk down. So be happy to talk to you.
As a member and as a customer, I get this big brochure, I guess you'd call it a catalog of all your films, especially the discounted films. How often does that come out?
It's all online. You know, everything is
all online. You don't no paper anymore.
The days of paper are sadly gone.
So I've got some real antique roadshow stuff
you
that I should keep. I was going to also ask you about how could a studio possibly pay for all the cops that need to cordon off everything downtown for Transformers, but they did it.
Oh yeah.
And that just must have really quintupled the budget for what they had to do. All the public services they had to. Am I right?
Well, I mean that I think is just comes as part and parcel to the production process. If you're going to close a street, it's going to take some people. And I should also mention that Alderman Vidaly, who's sitting here in the front row, who is a great advocate and partner and assistance in making that whole Lincoln Avenue thing possible for Public Enemies out on at the Biograph Theater. It does take city services to make that happen in a way that makes sense for the community, makes sense for traffic, makes sense for the residents and all of that. But productions know going into it that that's something that they're just going to have. It's just the way it is.
And if you had a dream of a film totally made in Chicago, I'm trying to think of Oprah's got her studio. She can do what she wants. Did you have anything to do with Oprah and her swan song thing on Michigan Avenue?
Michigan Avenue?
Yeah.
I tell you what, it helped pave the way for Transformers.
That's what I was going to ask.
The mayor's office of special events actually was and my office is part of special events, was very very much a part of the strategy of how to make this work, and that came together rather quickly.
And Oprah paid for all the cops, I'll bet.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's rich. She can do that.
She can do it. Well, I mean, when you've got a blockbuster budget in the form of like Transformers or Public Enemies, I mean, there's money there to pay for.
Are we going to miss? Is Harpo going to stay or her production company?
Well, her production company is still, from what I understand, is still going to be in Chicago producing content for whatever the network is going to be. So while her show will no longer be on the air, Harpo Productions and that West Side complex that has been evolving over the years is still going to be gearing up for doing shows that'll show up on her channel.
Okay. Fran, Do anyone have audience questions? No, I'm not hoarse, but I don't have too many more questions. There's a microphone right there if you'd like to step up. Ms. Ems, could you redirect him to it? Thank you.
I'm just curious, Rich, what we can look forward to? Anything in the works that we should...
Well, I tell you what's shooting right now is a movie called Contagion, which is a big star-studded ensemble piece that Steven Soderbergh is directing. And if you know Steven Soderbergh, he directed, in addition to all the Ocean's 11, Ocean's 12, he also does much smaller pieces with great talent. He directed a movie called Traffic, which...
He did Kafka? Did he do a Kafka film?
Did Kafka. He made an experimental film called Schizopolis. He seems to make... big blockbusters for the studios that make a lot of money, and in return they give him the opportunity to make little vanity projects. And while Contagion is hardly a vanity project, it's not the big blockbuster production. In fact, it's much more of a suspense thriller about a runaway killer virus that's spreading throughout the country, and people are dropping like flies, frankly, and the race, Matt Damon and Gwyneth Paltrow and Kate Winslet and Jude Law, as part of the ensemble. It's essentially the story of scientists racing to find a vaccine. That's currently shooting in Chicago right now.
It's called Outbreak 2, isn't it?
You know what? In fact, Warner Brothers, who's producing it, said, didn't we make this movie? And it kind of flopped a long time ago. So there's some.
Who was in that? Dustin Hoffman?
It was Dustin Hoffman wearing that suit, and it was like a monkey virus or something like that. This one, it's supposed to be a lot better.
pretty yellow suits. I remember the yellow suits. Do we have any more questions? You should have. Yes.
In that movie clips section, a tour guy gave an explanation of Second City that I've never heard before. I thought we were Second City because we had second population to New York, and now third because L.A. got in front of us. But he said we were the rebirth of the city. Which anyone who
I would buy yours.
Sure?
I would never buy the one that I heard there. It might be the rebirth city, the Phoenix city, but not the Second City.
I don't know. That may have been.
Anybody else ever heard that? I've never heard that before. But it was population. I'm a positive. We were always the second biggest.
It was in the New Yorker magazine many years ago. It was A.J. Liebling who actually called us the Second City.
Yeah.
Not the Windy City. Really. Check it out.
Check your fix.
There actually were some movies shot in Chicago long before the Blues Brothers, Call Northside 777 and a couple of other film noir movies and so forth. I wonder, if there's any information about, what the city did in terms of when people came to make movies back in the 40s and the 50s and so forth. And by the way, above the law, the people from that movie were on the rooftop of my building because it was next to the Armitage L stop. And even though it says Damon on the L stop and above the law, that was actually the Armitage L stop because I heard all the shooting.
Well, you may have heard, I've always heard stories that people made movies either under the radar or paid people off or did whatever they needed to do. Robert Altman, in fact, made films in Chicago or TV shows, in fact, in Chicago back in the 60s. And there really wasn't a process, from what I understand, there really wasn't a process set up. There certainly wasn't the embrace of the film industry back then. Mickey One, which is was a tremendous film that was shot in 65, maybe? Yeah. 60, somewhere in that neighborhood. I'm sure that was just made without telling anybody what they were doing.
I just saw a terrific independent film made in the 68 called Brandy in the Wilderness, part of which is by a filmmaker named Stanton Kaye, which is kind of a legendary film of independent American cinema, a lot of which is shot in Chicago, just as kind of a road movie, I'm sure, totally under the radar.
I'm interested in that question. I teach a course in Chicago in fiction, and I'm going to go to the library and see if there are any on Chicago in film and how those things went. it'll probably have the producer, director, and who signed the contracts, but as far as the technology and the people that actually worked on it, the only thing I can tell you is Northside 777 is about the time of my cousins, and there's a big newspaper, they have to blow up a headline and send it to the state pen or something to save somebody's life, and my cousins were newsboys, and they got to stand on the stoop when they threw them off the truck, so they did hire extras, and they used to throw dollars at them for working, so I doubt that much they know.
I actually had a question regarding extras. I mean, how can you become an extra in a film? Do you need professional acting experience? Or is it possible, I mean, are there casting calls? How does it work if you have no experience and you just really want to be in the background?
You know, it doesn't really require experience. If having done it means you can follow direction a little bit better, obviously that's a plus. But I think many people get into being extras just as you said, it sounds fun, it sounds interesting. I will say this, it can be grueling. I mean, it can be a long day, and oftentimes a very boring day of sitting around waiting for somebody to sort of herd you into a street scene where you may feel a little bit anonymous. But oftentimes when, like Contagion, they literally just put out the word that they were having a big, it's not even an audition necessarily, it's more like a registration process where get your picture taken, you supply them with some vital information about how to contact you, and it can be as simple as that. And extras get paid somewhere in the neighborhood of, I think, like about $100 to $150 a day these days.
How do you find out about it, though? Do you call
In fact, if we know of any sort of auditions or casting calls for it, it'll be on our website, and our website is chicagofilmoffice.us. But sometimes they'll put ads in the newspaper or on the radio.
The best way is to get lucky. We had a person that we knew from DePaul's theater school, worked in wardrobe. She got a job at MGM down in Disney World. And my daughter was crazy about Annie, and they were remaking Annie, not the one with Carol Burnett, the one with Victor Garber. And they were shooting it in Disney World at MGM. And we happened to be staying there that week. And I called this gal, and she got us to sit in the audience for the NYC, da-da-da-da-da. And we got to sit in the audience when the original Annie, Andrea McCardle, did a Hoofer singer number on the stage, and that drove my daughter crazy because she saw the original Annie as a 30-year-old. But if you get lucky and somebody tells you, we didn't get paid, the suckers didn't give us a dime. We just sat there and watched.
I don't know if this was discussed or not. But Chicago and other U.S. cities have had competition, especially from Canada, Toronto, Vancouver, places, because film costs, production costs are less expensive, or they're more aggressive in their bidding in Canada. I don't know. Has Chicago done things, especially with unions and other ways, to be more creative in trying to make costs more beneficial for production companies?
Well, you're right. The competition for where films are made these days is extraordinarily fierce. I don't think it's ever been as competitive as it is right now. Canada first got into the business of courting the film industry, specifically to start it out the television industry, just because of the exchange rate. A buck was worth $1.30 up in Toronto and Vancouver and Montreal, and filmmakers realized that they could just save a whole lot of money just by crossing the border. That led them then to start offering rebates, literally like write a check to say for every dollar you spend in Canada, we'll give you a certain percentage back. And then eventually the U.S. States started catching up with that, although at that point Canada had such a vibrant film industry going, it was tough to compete with. But currently the state of Illinois does offer a 30% tax credit for every dollar a producer spends in Illinois. The state of Illinois will issue a tax credit. And it's a very competitive incentive. It's not nearly as competitive as some other places. Michigan, believe it or not, has got one of the biggest incentives out there. I think they're trying to essentially retool the auto industry there. And they offer 42% of every dollar spent on an entire production. So they're giving some major dollars back. But because of the overall production value of what Chicago can offer in terms of the not to sound like a salesperson here, but the great locations and the sort of distinctive look of Chicago and the quality of the crew and the ability to cast from Chicago theater companies out of Steppenwolf and Goodman and Looking Glass, producers and directors love that type of talent. the overall production value of Chicago is already very strong, and then you put a 30% tax credit in place on top of that, it makes it very, very attractive. But we get the movie Chicago was all made in Toronto, and that's perhaps what drove people to finally say, hey, we're really missing the boat here in terms of what is not coming here to shoot. You know, Chicago, within North America, I would say Chicago is always perhaps from the top five cities, but we certainly are pale in comparison to New York and certainly Los Angeles and Toronto. But once you get beyond that sort of upper crust tier of huge production centers, Chicago has managed to survive a lot of the drought that has come and gone. It's been very cyclical here, but we're far from being the recognized capital of film production by any stretch. Although we have seen over the years, if you look dating back to the 70s and things like that, there's been steady growth here in terms of on-location film production, tremendous growth in terms of indigenous film production, independent filmmakers. There used to be maybe one or two every year, now there's 20 to 30 independent films every year, but that has a lot to do with the cost of just making a film these days. But I would say we're certainly recognized as a place where film happens, just not in the numbers that it happens and more recognized. And part of that is that New York and Los Angeles are the corporate homes of the entertainment conglomerates that make most of the entertainment in this country, so. Right.
Finkelsteel is gonna be moving out of the neighborhood, and I was wondering what you thought if that property was redeveloped as production studios and how that would positively impact bringing movies to Chicago.
Finkelsteel's moving out of the neighborhood?
Will Goyvich is not here to keep it going.
I didn't know that Finkel was going there. Well, in fact, not Finkel so much, but on the southwest side, Ryerson Steel, which has several facilities here in Chicago, has been closed and they've been trying to sell that. There's a company out of Toronto called Cinespace, which has been in the process of trying to buy that and turn it into what would be the largest soundstage facility outside of Los Angeles and all of North America. And Cinespace has got a track record. They run three very successful facilities up in Toronto, and they've got massive acreage and just the right specification of super high ceilings and clear span floor space. That facility has been, Transformers actually did some, they didn't shoot there, but they housed some equipment and did some fabrication there. Those types of facilities are a great draw. It doesn't necessarily mean that if you have a facility like that, people are going to automatically come. You have to have other inducements and other reasons for people to shoot here. But that would be, for us, fill a big gap in terms of what is the overall production infrastructure that Chicago can offer, and with an operator that is well-respected within the industry. So I don't know about Finkel as being sort of a north side tandem to that. Hey, one thing I did is talk about things to look for. The same woman who is producing Contagion, Stacey Scheer, her company Double Features, is also developing the Devil in White City novel with Leonardo DiCaprio. So there's great hope and expectation that that would be shot here in Chicago. It seems to me like the type of production that would probably do a lot in the way of computer-generated imagery to recreate that time, obviously, and and something that would cost an enormous amount of money to build.
In the meantime, before that gets made, you can go and watch an independent film made here called H.H. Holmes by John Borowski, which is on, this, on the story of the White City.
He's the killer in the Great White City. Are you going to buy Finkelsteel and expand?
I think it's a great idea.
It's due south of you, am I right? Three blocks.
Installation there, like video art and, you know, show.
It'll be cool.
Inside, outside.
If we have a lull and you want to break into films, go through your kids. That's how to get into film. My one niece has two twin boys, dynamite-looking kids. And they became child models. And it just means she can't have a job. She was a teacher. She quit it so she could pick up a phone and they'd say, bring your kids right here and there. They did it as infants, and you need twins because you can only work so many hours and all that. Then they made a movie called A Will of Their Own with Thomas Gibson and Leah Thompson. And they needed a boy for this soldier, Thomas Gibson, to come back and kiss or something like that. And Tony was picked, and there was a kid younger that was going to fit the bill better. And then instead, Nick was picked because he might look younger, and eventually gave it to the twins because they could read, and this punk kid, three-year-old, he couldn't read, so he didn't get to roll. That was $5,000 for 2 days' work. More recently, and this is a future, a friend of ours from Cedar Rapids has a son who is Billy Madison, one of the ones playing downtown. We got to see a special production. We sat up front in the $300 seats for, I think it was $20. And what happened there is the family put him in ballet, Ty, when he was about 3 years old. And then from Cedar Rapids, he went to the University of Iowa at 8, and he made an audition, and he looked good. So they promoted him to go to Milwaukee. Apparently, Milwaukee's got a huge spread in ballet, and he made it there. So they sent him to the Royal Ballet School in Canada. And he spent a year and a half there, and then he got picked as one of the four Billy Madisons. Now, here's what you go through with the kid, because I was talking to his mom. She's had to homeschool him for 4 years up there, and as he goes on the road. He has a six-month contract. It's an obscene amount of money. For that, he has to do two performances, and then, because he's young, then he gets two backups. He has to show up in case one of the kids who's leading sick, and he has to do that. Those are his easy days. He has two other days. He has to go to the studio, and they have 8 hours of calisthenics, fencing, trapeze, because he has to fly around, dancing, vocal lessons. It's just enormous. And then in his off day, he spends getting homeschooled with his mom. And I asked Ty, how much social life do you have? He said, my mom is my friend. That's about it. And then he said, I get 30 minutes before the show to talk to the girls. There's some girls in the cast and a couple of boys that play with me. And right after, before we go to see our parents, we get to talk while we stretch for 30 minutes after a performance. And he's going to do that for 6 months. And then he says, probably I'll never get a starring role. Andrea McCardle, who played Annie on Broadway, got a Tony for it. I don't think ever got another starring role. So that's the risk. But his money is obscene. I won't tell you how much, but it's a lot. Wish I could make that much.
Well, you can say that, you know, many, many child stars end up as very sad and unhappy adults, yeah, unfortunately.
True.
Could I just follow up with the comment that we were about fifth in the nation film? Based on your experience, what kinds of things do you think you could do to attract more films or more?
I think it's the money. I think you have to have the people, and this could certainly change with Chicago maturing as a place where film production happens, where suddenly, particularly from an independent film center, I think Chicago is still rather loyal to the conservative city for investment in film production. I think there are people who invest in films here, probably more likely to invest in a film being made in Los Angeles because they feel like it's a safer bet. They assume that there's a greater track record there and there's bound to be more success. I think local filmmakers have a tough time raising money here, and as a result, they go where the money is, and we lose talent all the time in efforts that people want to make their film, and they got to go to Los Angeles or New York, where there's, a greater appreciation or at least a greater comfort level with investing in film. But I would say that a more committed financial investment community would make a difference. But it doesn't take, frankly, if there's, the city of Austin, Texas, has a very strong film community, and it's built mostly on the backs of Robert Rodriguez and Richard Linklater. Sure. People, native Chicagoans who have risen to that level of success where they can sort of dictate where they're going to make their films, they've been very loyal and very interested. And frankly, people like being in Chicago. There's a quality of life that I think people enjoy. It's not as harsh as either coast, and I think people, but not everybody who's in the industry is going to want to live in Chicago, and that's something that we face.
Rich, if you had a major star, say Phil Murray, I'm thinking of Tribeca and De Niro as the model, and he's Tribeca basically is New York. If you had somebody like Phil Murray invest the time, the money, and store it at Tribeca here, would that be the fulcrum?
I think it certainly would help. I mean, Vince Vaughn is talking about doing something just like that.
He's about the most faithful of them all.
These days, yeah.
Yeah.
And how do you sort of aid that along? How do you nurture that process? I'm not entirely sure if there is a special formula for that. Some of it just has to happen organically, and some of it just has to be the success of the films. That there's a lot of films that come out of Chicago, and God bless them, there's, like in every film community, there's a lot of stuff that is just isn't going to get the attention of everybody. It's not going to be viewed well critically, but there are films that are creating more of a presence of a Chicago film community that gets recognition on the festival circuit, that gets some distribution. And I think the more that happens, the more people are going to decide to stay in Chicago, and I think the more money that's going to flow to those people in an effort to get their projects made. And that, much like a Robert De Niro, who championed Chicago, New York's independent film community, perhaps somebody like a Vince Vaughn or somebody who is yet to emerge will come along and say, "Hey, I really want to create Chicago as a player on that same level."
I think that's kind of a perfect note to end on. I would be remiss, I must say, just to comment on something that came up during the program. If I didn't say, although we have huge respect for our colleagues at Columbia College, we also have a wonderful theater school here at DePaul University, which I think is our contribution to the film and the theater world. And we have to play that up a bit, I think.
Absolutely.
I want to, yes, Hugh.
If you haven't seen it, Stranger Than Fiction was written by a DePaul theater student, and if you haven't rented it, you should rent it. At the end, he and the producer have a large discussion in these scene selections, and he talks about creating the film and how they discovered they could use a watch as a character and this and that. And he talks about DePaul, and he was a nobody, and he had great talent, and it was recognized. He made one of the best films with Will Ferrell I've ever seen. It's a wonderful film.
Well, see, there you go. So let me thank first Hugh Ingrasci, our wonderful moderator, Milos Stehlik, and Rich Moskal. I cannot thank you enough for coming and joining us tonight at DePaul. We are very grateful to you. You were wonderful and fascinating, all three of you. And we can continue the conversation back in our reception area if you would like. But for the moment, I think we will thank you for coming tonight and for being such a wonderful audience. And please join us again. We'll have another program in the spring, and we will be contacting all of you. And keep our research initiative in mind, please. We have been together now for 12 years, I guess, going on 13 years, and we appreciate your support, and we hope that you will continue to support us as the years go on. Thank you very much. Thank you, gentlemen.